Welcome everybody to my presentation about the use of runtime types at Lexify. Let me start with a short introduction. Lexify is a software company with clients in the financial sector. Based on a generic algebraic description for financial products, they can automate many aspects around managing diverse portfolios. Lexify maintains code for pricing, risk assessment, reporting, document generation, and lifecycle management. Technologically sophisticated tools are exposed via graphical user interfaces on Windows and the web stack. For all of this, and since almost 20 years, Lexify uses OCaml as primary programming language. To put it short, Lexify is a group of professional OCamaliers. This stands in contrast to me, Patrick. I'm neither a programming languages guy nor a professional OCaml user. I'm also not very familiar with Lexify's codebase. I'm merely an intern who started to use OCaml a few years ago. However, I deem the results of my internship rather interesting. I will use this opportunity to present what I did during the summer of 2018. Let's start from the beginning. This is what I saw on my first day at Lexify. Certainly, something is off here. How can it be that this debug function is able to print values of any type? So I went on and had a look at the implementation of debug, only to become even more surprised. As you can see, the function matches on the type of the value to be printed. The type is read from an additional argument labeled T. But where does the type argument T come from? I didn't provide it at the call site, right? I had to consult my supervisor, Mark. It turns out that Lexify maintains a modified compiler that implicitly adds the omitted argument. The compiler's type checker derives the type of the debugged value. The compiler extension then synthesizes a new value of type T type, which is nothing less than a runtime representation of the value to be debugged. Knowing this, debug became much less magical to me. Now I was able to grasp my task, namely to replace Lexify's compiler extension with a more ecosystem-compliant syntactic preprocessor. After a few weeks, I came up with what we see here. I wrote a PPX deriver that synthesizes an equivalent runtime representation before compilation. The runtime types are inserted into the AST. In the example on the left, you can see that they become available under name of type underscore T. Type variables, as in alpha list, are represented as functions. Consequently, list has to be instantiated before use. In the example, I do that by calling list T with argument bar T. Equivalently, I could instruct the PPX to handle instantiation for me. This happens with the syntax in the lower part. Based on this approach, I was able to provide a quite complete implementation of Lexify runtime types. In contrast to the original implementation, it works on standard OCaml. Best thing, it is now publicly available and nothing stops you from checking it out from GitHub. I'll provide a link in the chat. But why should you? How is this any good? Assume your daily task is to implement user interfaces for CRUD-style applications. You quickly become bored of the slightly varying, but mostly repetitive tasks. You want to automate what you can. You've heard of PPX deriving, a system for deriving code from type definition. You also heard that it's a bit tedious to work with. Thus, you shy away from implementing your own PPX derivers. What else could you do? You could use Lexify runtime types. Let's look at a more realistic example for that. A nested form for login and contact information, such as this one. You can see two useful but boring types. Plugging together a user interface for editing such accounts will take some time. But not at Lexify. There, someone already implemented a generic user interface based on runtime types. Creating a Windows form is as easy as calling a function with a runtime type and some initial data as arguments. The rest happens automatically. But wait, something must be off again. How does it know that the ID field is supposed to be read-only? And password and address are of type string, just like most of the other fields, but somehow they are treated differently. This is because I omitted a few things from the type definition on the previous slide. Lexify runtime types can carry properties. You can add them using annotations of this kind. Internally, they will end up as key value pairs attached to the runtime type. The form creating function checks for certain keys and, if present, takes into account the corresponding values. In this example, we add a read-only property and an initialization value to the ID field. We also change a label from last name to surname. We hide the password and make the address a multiple line input. These properties are attached to the runtime type itself. The form creating function is merely consuming them. Consequently, they can be consumed by other functions as well. For example, Lexify also maintains code that creates web forms from runtime types. By changing the module from WinForm to WebForm, you can create an equivalent user interface for a different stack. Of course, we are not limited to user interfaces. We can also derive conversion functions. JSON is actually part of the published Lexify runtime type repository, database schema, and database interfacing code. Now that we know why runtime types are useful, let's have a look at some technical aspects. We have seen this example before. Debug takes a runtime type, we call it ttype, and extracts type information using the function stype of ttype. The serializable stype is used for introspection, but it does not carry type witnesses. We have to convince the type checker about X being of a certain type using an unsafe function. Internally, the ttype is nothing else than the stype. The compiler extension generates untyped stypes and then casts them to the corresponding typed ttypes. Since backwards compatibility was a main goal, the new PPX sticks to the same representation. However, since GADTs are a thing, it is possible to extend the S-type with witnesses for the values type. The X-type of T-type function does exactly that. As you can see, no unsafe functions are needed in the resulting introspective code. Unfortunately, the X-type GADT definition is too long to fit the slides. I will post a link to its documentation in the chat. If you follow the link, you will see that we support safe introspection of the most common primitive types, tuples, sum types, and records. I will go into one interesting example here. Let's have a look at this simple coordinate type. It has two fields, x and y, of type float. The corresponding x-type representation will look like this. Its main component is the list of fields. Each field has a label, in this case x or y, a list of properties, here empty, and a runtime type, here the x-type representation of float. It is worth noting that all involved constructors and records are private. This means that we can read them but not tweak them. Consequently, the inner field values constitute proof that the coordinate record actually has a float field at the indicated position. As a result, the representation contains enough information to infer the corresponding OCaml memory layout. So, we can use it to safely access fields. But it also works the other way around. We can construct new record values. We are not yet sure about the right interface for doing that. Thus, we provide multiple options. One of them is shown here. We use it to create a coordinate from a string float SOC list. To satisfy the interface, we have to pretend that we could convert the supplied floats into record fields of any type. Obviously, this example would fail if there were fields of other type than float. Yeah. That's it for records. Let's have a look at abstract types, where we have to deal with a conceptual problem. Runtime types are designed for looking into the type definition, while abstract types do exactly the opposite. We try to resolve this by encoding abstract types as string. In the example on the left, the runtime type of the first date type will be an introspective int. The exposed runtime type of the second date will hide this fact. In order to handle abstract types at runtime, think of a custom form interface for a hidden type, we provide a matching mechanism. For the purpose of this talk, we will quickly step through an example that matches runtime types for to string conversion. More detailed information can be found following the link I provide in the chat. We start by defining an alpha to string type. Next, we create a matcher module that is able to return values of type alpha to string. We also define a reference to an empty to string matcher. We will later update this reference to add matching cases. Our generic to string conversion function applies the matcher and uses the matched conversion function on the supplied value x. If no registered case matches the given runtime type, the function returns a placeholder string opaque. The boilerplate code is a bit verbose because we can register cases with three type variables. If we now try to print values using the new generic to string function, we will end up with opaque output. This has to be, since no matching cases are yet registered. After adding a matcher case for int to string conversion, the to string conversion function can handle integers. A list of integers still results in an opaque string because there is no matching case for lists. Luckily, it is more or less straightforward to add a generic case for alpha lists. After doing so, toString can handle int lists and float lists. However, as expected, the floats themselves are still opaque. Internally, the matcher orders the registered runtime types, builds a discrimination tree, and efficiently instantiates type variables during lookup. Consequently, applying a matcher is much faster than sequentially applying runtime type equality on the individual matching cases. On the downside, we introduce a serious safety issue here. Remember that abstract types are represented merely as strings. These strings are either derived from a file and type name or provided by the programmer. Both options can yield collisions, especially when restoring a runtime type that was serialized using a different version of the program. Another problem arises from GADTs. It would be useful to have runtime representations for some of them. Let's take this dynamic as an example. It provides a generic box for values and their runtime type representation. Can we have a representation for dynamic and use it to handle heterogeneous lists? My intuition says yes. However, I'm not sure how an introspective X-type representation for this GADT should look like. Also, I think that we cannot support all possible GADTs. Similarly, we probably run into problems with module types. However, for a proper argument in that direction, I could need some help. Speaking about help, I should probably mention that I did not come up with all of this on my own. Most of what we've seen today existed at Lexify long before my internship. In fact, a good portion of it, namely the internally used compiler extension, was presented at this workshop 7 years ago. Also, outside of Lexify, runtime types are a common concept. To me, it seems that many great minds think about it since before I first booted a computer. I'm not the right guy to provide an exhaustive list, but let me mention a few. There's DynType, which derives a serializable type representation similar to our S-type using CamelP4. There's a combinator library in Ermin that can be used to produce something similar to our X-type. Also ChainStreet has type representations. Last year, Oleg showcased another implementation and matching mechanism on the mailing list. Ivan answered that the binary analysis platform has runtime types too, and that they rely on an ordering for efficient matching just as we do. Another recent implementation is REFL. This one even supports some GADTs. All in all, it seems that there is consensus about runtime types being useful. To me, it also seems that there is some convergence on a subset of implementation choices. However, sadly, everybody is going their own way. Maybe it's about time to think about a common solution. What do you think? With this question, I want to open up the discussion. Thank you for following my presentation, and thanks, LexiFee, for providing a great internship experience.